Welcome back to the coverage of YCS London. My name is Oliver Gurman and I'm your host for the weekend, and I'm joined by Matthew Bell.
Hey everyone, how are you doing today?
We have made it to round 4 out of 8 that we're going to play today at a Swiss portion of the tournament.
Yep.
That means because we got two players that haven't dropped the game yet, we will have a player with 3-0 going up against another player with 3-0. So they are, well, we will see less misplays most likely.
Yeah, we're going to start getting to the point where the tournament starts filtering into the more experienced players that are generally winning their matches.
Right.
Well, I say generally, of course they're winning, otherwise they wouldn't be 3-0, but the players that are winning their matches and the players that are losing their matches. So,
well, so far we have seen Shadol dominating the feature matches quite a bit, with the one exception of the Burning Abyss deck in the very first round, if I'm not mistaken.
Jake Quincy's match.
Jake Quincy's match. So, in between rounds, I just took the time talking to some players outside, and Ali Fawaz, one of the also veterans of the game, who was on a long hiatus but now came back, said that Shadol at the moment, in his opinion, is the deck to beat. And the main reason is that all the other decks rely on Exceed monsters.
Yeah,
and as soon as you bring something from the extra deck to the field, Shadol will punish you for that.
Yep, Shadol Fusion, the cheaty face fusion spell.
Right.
So that deck is so good against extra deck reliant decks.
Yep.
You're beating that deck with the power of your normal summon if you're going to go up against it. But then normal summons are so slow.
Well, Ali said that in America,
just like that, was it?
Yeah, pretty much like that. That players are relying more on Burning Abyss, with one of the reasons why is that they just think that the trap cards can make the difference. So he's like, okay, so how am I going to build my deck? I have the Shadol core, and not the card core, but like the...
I get what you're saying.
And what do I add to that? And then he's like, okay, 3 copies of Trap Stun, for example, maybe a Wiretap, maybe 2 copies of Wiretap, and there you have it, pretty much. That's like all it takes, according to him.
Oh, he sounds pretty confident.
He was perfectly confident, and one of his friends who he's playing with all the time is Marcelo Barbieri, and he's going to go up against Michael Ciplak in our feature match. Now, Michael Ciplak is a name you might remember if you have been a long-time follower of our coverage. He has been one of the few players that, like, after 3, 4, even 5 events, was one of the very few that advanced to the top cut of every single European YCS.
Really?
So, wow. Very consistent player. Even more surprising is he changed decks all the time. This guy really doesn't like to play with the same deck in two tournaments in a row. So we have seen him with a Harpy deck, if I'm not mistaken. We've seen it quite a few times with Fire Kings, which he's also going to play today. And once or twice, he also went with the more obvious choices that...
One of the big decks that are out there.
While he's not officially affiliated with some other players, he's from Austria. He plays together with, as far as I know, Claudio Kirchmeier and Peter Gross, who are also some household names.
They could just open a dojo on top of a mountain and just like... I can imagine... like Peter Gross with his big beard, sitting there with gray hair, and someone climbing the mountain going, I've come to learn Yu-Gi-Oh! And Peter's around going, well, let's get started.
Umut Serin, who has been feeding me information last weekend, is also, he said that Peter Gross, in his group of players that they test with, Peter Gross is like the best player he knows. He says this guy is crazy about Yu-Gi-Oh!
He's phenomenal.
His one problem is that he's like too much into it. So he sometimes he wants to come up with even stranger choices for his deck, and sometimes he's like too many steps ahead of the competition.
Yeah,
which means that he's gonna lose out.
So he goes, okay, so they're gonna do this, I'm gonna do this, and then I'm gonna also think about this. And of course, when the group of people don't think about it, he's like, oh,
the opposition just stopped a little bit earlier. So there you have the two players that we mentioned. Michael on the left side, the flag. Is the Austrian flag, just in case you're not familiar with that.
Yeah, it's not the Denmark flag. I mean, whoever said that was just wrong. Yeah,
exactly. And on the right-hand side, we got Marcelo Barbieri from Italy, one of the many Italian superstars that are doing really well. Here we got the cards in hand for Michael. I expect you to not be familiar with all of them, not these particular cards. Oh, there we have one, Fire King High Avatar Garunix. That's one card you don't see every day.
Yeah, it's a really powerful monster that just keeps coming back, and every time it's special summoned, it will destroy all other monsters on the field. So you create this situation for your opponent where it's very hard for them to deploy any monsters because you've got this recurring threat. If they destroy it, with a card effect, it just comes back.
Yes.
And then it takes out a bunch of guys with it, and there's ways to cheat it into play. I'm not seeing any copies of Trade-In. Yeah, it's a level 8 monster, right? Just to be sure I'm not making a fool out of myself. I'm pretty sure
yes,
that
Garunix...
Yeah. So there's no copies of Trade-In in here yet. He's playing 3 copies of Fire King Avatar Garunix. He doesn't actually have any way of discarding copies from his hand either, so that would be interesting to see if his hand gets jammed at some point in the tournament.
Normally you would expect him to either run Phoenix Wing Windblast or, well, like you said, the Trade-In. But for some reason, Michael doesn't do that. Marcelo started the game. He's got Sinister Shadow Games, Wiretap, and a Shadow Hedgehog. That is a very good setup for him with Shadow Skomamata and Shadow Beast in hand.
I don't know if we explained what deck he was playing, but he's playing something that seems very similar to Joshua Smith's deck, the Artifact Shadow deck. It seems very, very standard, straightforward deck, what you'd come to expect from a Shadow deck at this point.
Well, I mean, maybe not the best choice for a smaller tournament, but if you have to play so many rounds, very consistent deck should be on top of your agenda.
Yeah, if you've like got a reliable deck, it should get you there. It's like if you're doing a lot of driving, you want a car that's not going to break down.
Yes.
Where I believe this Fire King deck could break down when he draws this free Fire King Avatar Garunixes.
Right. So, Michael Sacking, the Fire King Avatar Garunix, not to be confused with the High Avatar. That is a little bit confusing when you first see those cards, isn't it?
A little bit, yeah. But we'll do our best to get the hang of
sure.
this.
So there's like a small version and a high-level version. The small version only has 3 level stars, and it says if a face-up Viking monster you control is destroyed by a card effect, that means itself as well. Except during the damage step, you can special summon this card from your hand. And if it is destroyed by your opponent's card and sent to your graveyard, you can special summon 1 Fire King Avatar monster from your deck. Good. So, Michael now has the High Avatar on the field, and he adds Brotherhood of the Fire Fist Bear after Marcelo took a little bit slow approach and simply set a breakthrough skill, which you can see here, and passed right back. So now Michael wants to go in, and this is where the magic happens.
Yeah, Michael's attack is going to be met with a Sinister Shadow Games, which will flip up the face-down monster, which is a Shadow Dragon, which will be able to return a card on the field to its owner's hand. Key thing there is that the Fire King will not be destroyed. Oh, okay, so we're going to see a Chain Compulsory Evacuation and Wiretap being forced out.
Well, there is the Wiretap that we talked about prior to the beginning of this round. So,
yeah, an aggressive chain there, but it's... You can definitely tell Michael was prepared for this Sinister Shadow Games.
Yes. He was... I guess that's the reason why he didn't attack the turn before. He wanted to have his trap cards being live first.
Yeah, I imagine running that High Avatar into Shadow Dragon is awful. But he wouldn't have known that, and the Hedgehog. Did he search for the Dragon through the Hedgehog?
Not 100% sure.
You know what? I'm having a memory lapse, so let's just see what happens rather than what already happened.
Right. So Marcelo is currently thinking about what to send to the graveyard.
Shadow Falco being the selected card, and Dragon being flipped up, which will return the High Avatar.
Yeah, that is one of the best ways to get rid of the High Avatar. Because you don't mind if it's on the hand.
Yeah, especially as we talked about before, the only way I can see Michael, getting that out of his hand is by tribute summoning it, and that's not a very reliable plan.
Well, he's got the way to special summon it with the avatars.
Oh yeah, of course. Yeah, sorry.
I think that's his preferred way of getting them to the field. All right, so it is Marcelo's turn, as you can see, because he just changed the battle position of his Shadow Dragon on the field. And in case you're wondering, his cards in hand, here we got them. He's a Shadow Squamata, Shadow Beast, and a Shadow Falco.
Quite a monster heavy hand, but still there's a lot of options available with those cards. Michael, considering whether or not he lets this attack through from the looks of things with that Shadow Dragon, he's got a Brotherhood of the Fire Fist Bear. If he can get any damage thrown on his opponent, he'll start searching for those Fire Formation cards, which can start letting him get ahead. Oh, okay, there's a breakthrough skill being used. to prevent the Brotherhood of the Fire Fist triggering if this attack goes through. Marcelio preempting any kind of shenanigans with the Brotherhood Fire Fist.
Yes. And Marcelo, also a very experienced player, by the way. He also advanced to the top 8 of the European Championship this year, so he was very close to making it to the World Championship. But
that's the worst loss you can ever get yes. in a Yu-Gi-Oh! Tournament. It's a top 8 of the European Championships.
That is true, yes. Good. So the bear has left the field. There's only a bottomless trap hole left, but that will change momentarily because it's Michael's turn again, and he's going for Coach Soldier Wolfbark, of course.
Yeah, this will land create a rank 4 player and open up this entire toolbox of options he's got in his extra deck. I'm wondering which choice he's going to go for here. It is the Fire King, the Fire Fist Tiger King, which will allow him to search for another Fire Formation card.
Right. Those are the most powerful Exceed monsters that allow you to, like, disadvantage of losing two cards right away again. So there's really no risk in going for them, is there?
No, in most situations it's incredibly powerful. Getting the Fire Formation Tenki as well and then being able to search his deck for anything he needs, whilst also now controlling the biggest monster in play, is very awesome for him.
Right.
So there's going to be a little bit of damage coming in from this attack.
Yeah, that's the first blood in this match. And Marcelo, it's been a while since we've seen Tiger King at the top table, so he has to read the card.
Yeah, I would definitely take a look at it, because it has one of those lesser-known effects as well. When it's destroyed, you can send three Fire Formations to the graveyard to summon cards. And that's the kind of effect that catches you off, because it's not something that happens every duel.
Yeah.
And when you're playtesting, you can playtest maybe 10 games and not use that effect.
Right.
And be caught off on the 11th one when it happens. But
funny thing is, a funny story about Fire Kings and Michael Chiplak. He was going up against Alpai Ng in the other. It's one of the last events. And Alpai didn't know that Fire King High Avatar Garunix would not come back. I don't know why exactly, if it got tributed or something like that.
Oh, because it wasn't destroyed by a card effect.
Yeah, I think so. I think that's the reason. And so Alpai just expects it to come back rather than reading the card. And he doesn't want to make a fool out of himself in the feature match, like looking like a new player and reading every card. And he just shuffles up. And Michael is sitting there. He looks really confused. Signs the result entry slip, of course, because he wants to make sure that the win is coming through. Alpai signs the result entry slip, and the first thing that Michael says is like, what just happened? He's like, why did you give up? And then Alpai is like, yeah, I thought the High Avatar is going to come back, and I'm just going to lose the game. And he's like, did you read the card? And he's like, no, I don't read cards.
I don't read cards.
He's like, I'm all playing again. I don't read cards. And then, and everybody, we have this on the written coverage. And in the top 8 profiles, later on, we asked some players, hey, what's been the best move you've seen this weekend? And everybody agreed, Michael Chiplak beating Alpai Engin in a situation where he actually lost the game, but Alpai just shuffled up because he was too lazy to read a card.
That's incredible. I think that's... I'm Alpai Engin, I don't need to read cards. That's that's a quote right there.
Right, so there you have it. Marcelo playing a little bit more defensively here with Shadow Falco and Artifact Sanctum. The Artifact Engine, the other reason, according to Ali Favas, why Shadow should not be discarded anytime soon, because it just gives you so much consistency and chances to react in your opponent's turn.
Yeah, we saw the artifacts being incredibly disruptive at the WCQ. You still get that now. And the Morale Tax also act as the light side of all of your Chaos Fusions or your Constructs. Chaos Fusions, your Blackluster Soldiers or Chaos Sorcerers or whatever else you're playing. And they just fit so well together. And it discourages your opponent from just blindly playing their Spawn and Trap removal into your back row.
Yes.
Because they feel like they're just going to be punished by one of these artifact monsters.
So here you see the hand of Michael Chiplak, and it's clocking up a little bit with the High Avatars. The cards he doesn't want to draw, if I'm not all too mistaken. And with our great side view, you can see both players the way they are sitting there. They seem to be somewhat tense, somewhat nervous, both of them.
Yeah, I think after these early exchanges, both players have realized the other one is quite prepared for this match.
Yeah.
Based on how that very first change, you could make a gauge of your opponent's skill and reading level. Well, by reading, not can they read your cards, but rather can they anticipate what you're going to do.
Yeah, but I think both of these are perfectly aware of the other being really good at this game.
Yeah, I don't think either of them have... Well, there's a good chance that neither of them have turned up and just gone, oh, that guy, he doesn't know what he's doing.
Yeah. All right. So here is the Shadol Fusion, the signature card of the Shadol deck. Here we have it. Since Michael is currently controlling a monster that was special summoned from the extra deck, you can basically activate the fusion card for free. That's what players like to call it.
The free fusion.
Yeah. What they mean by that is that you don't have to discard anything from your hand. You can fuse monsters out of your deck together to a very powerful monster. In this card, the El Shadol Construct.
Construct causes a huge number of problems for so many decks. To get over a 2800 attack monster in battle, you're probably going to need to special summon. If you try to attack into an El Shadol Construct with a special summon monster, the Shadol Construct just destroys your monster at the start of the damage step. So, and it replaces itself if you do destroy it with a card effect. So it's a really hard monster to deal with efficiently.
Yeah, especially if it gets special summoned with a Shadol Fusion for free.
Yeah, because then also those Shadol monsters, that Shadol monster you sent to the graveyard, it's also going to trigger, giving you cards.
Yep.
The Shadol Construct sends a card from the deck to the graveyard, so you then get another trigger. Very, very powerful card. Yep. And yeah, you need to look at, if you're playing an extra deck card, if you're playing a theme that depends on the extra deck, you need to consider how many free fusions can I give my opponent before there's no way I can win the game.
Yes. Right, so it seems like there's a little bit of a misunderstanding. I'm not 100% sure, but it seems like Marcelo is explaining again why he's fusing, or what he's fusing together, and what the...
It's probably how the chain is building, because he sent a Shadol Beast to the graveyard for fusion, then Construct is summoned, Construct is going to trigger after that.
And his Beast is going to trigger as well.
Yeah, there's a lot of things.
Here's Beast for you guys. We said before we can't show you the cards in the graveyard, but Marcelo is holding on to another copy. He's got Shadol Squamata, the Beast, and a Blackluster Soldier Envoy of the Beginning in his hand.
He already has a Blackluster Soldier.
Yeah.
That's pretty big, since he just sent the light monster that he needed from his deck straight to the graveyard with the Artifact Morale Tag.
Yeah. And what's the thinking when you're Michael Chiplak? When you see that the Moral Tag is getting sent to the graveyard, do you immediately expect the Blackluster Soldier to appear there?
I wouldn't expect it to immediately appear, but considering what my opponent's gone for, he knows that the Tiger King is going to be bigger than a Winder.
Yep.
So the only fusion monster that makes sense to go for is the Construct.
Right.
So I don't feel like that Construct really telegraphs anything other than I've looked at what you have on your side of the field.
Well, the situation on the field is still being resolved, so we got some back and forth. This time we do have a true communication issue, which is not that surprising, because first language of Michael is German, or Austrian, as some of you would like to call it. And the second language Marcelo is speaking is, of course, Italian. And we just have been told that there is an appeal, in case you are not familiar with that, if you are new to the game.
Yeah.
We got lots of judges in the room that are there to answer all your questions. Whenever something comes up, you just raise a hand and then you scream, I'm not going to do that right now. And then one of these helpful guys is coming up to you and answering your question.
Yeah, they'll come over and resolve the situation. However, you do sometimes get the case where you believe that the judge has given you information that you don't believe is correct.
For whatever reason, either because there was a language problem between you and the judge, communication error, or, well, sometimes you just know better. You're like, I know about this ruling that is not that known, to be honest.
Yeah. Yeah, you know, it could be a bit of a weird one, and you've done your research, and your judge has looked at the cards, made a decision, and you disagree with it based on the information you have. So you appeal to the head judge, and then the head judge comes over, and it's the final authority.
Right. Yeah, that's the key word there, final. Once the head judge has made a ruling, there is no way for you to change the ruling. Even if you, for some reason, know better and say, hey, I'm 100% sure this is not the right call, but this is why we got a head judge. And most of the time, and I would say like 95% of the time, the head judge is right. They sit down with Konami, in fact.
Yeah, part of the event, at the start, we sit down with the head judges and go through a list of questions they've been sent and held them out so they can actually run the event. when they're going through that. But yeah, even we can't overturn the decision of a head judge after they've made it on site. Otherwise, that would undermine the authority.
Right. While you're waiting, we have the standings for you. That will be right up on the screen. These are the round three standings. So you can see who is currently leading the field. Now, that is not such a strong indication, of course, because it's only three rounds and we're going to play 11. 11?
Yeah, we're playing eight rounds today, three rounds tomorrow.
Yeah. So it's a little bit premature to draw conclusions from this. However, you can if there's one of your mates, you can cheer them on and, hope for them to go all the way. And
we'll see if any of these players stay in the top 10 throughout the day.
We have some of these are very experienced players, especially Rusty Adler, a German player. I don't think he has been advancing to the top 32 so many times before, but he's like at every European event, and he's most of the time he's doing pretty well. And another player we've had in those top 10 was Leo Guinier from France, who did advance to the top 8 few times before, I'm pretty certain. At least once, but I think twice.
Oh, sounds like a pretty experienced player getting to a top cut of an event.
And of course, we like in every round we look at the top tables. We don't want to bring you a match that is like not relevant in the case that even if somebody wins, they are not going to be in the top 32, which is why we are focusing a little bit with our coverage to the supposedly better players, the players that.
Well, the players that have a chance of progressing into the tournament, because those are the decks that are winning and the ones that we believe that you'll be interested in. We want to try and feature as many decks that are cool and exciting as possible, but at some point we are going to make it to the top 32.
And we do have to find some middle ground, so even if all of you want to see one certain duelist, maybe the supposedly Australian duelist in the room, who we either didn't find in the standings because we only had one Sean Sullivan in our standings, and he was from Sheffield or something, which is not quite Australia as far as I'm aware.
As somebody messed up and believe that somebody's here when they're not.
Yeah. So, we're going to do that. We're going to look into what you're suggesting and try to feature those guys. In fact, I think Marcelo or Michael have been asked to come over to the feature match area once or twice.
Yeah.
Right. Another thing. I mean, you've just seen the standings, which is a first. We haven't had those before.
Yeah, that's a new one. PJ spent a lot of time in Photoshop creating all the backgrounds and little GIFs. The little images that come up and say,
yes.
Hey, who we are. That was really
neat. Just make it look better. Another new feature that we have are the polls. So on the Twitch chat, we will have polls and ask you questions like, who do you think is going to win this round? In this case, you can either vote for Michael or for Marcelo. And by casting your vote, you can give us an idea of what you guys think is the case. I can just bring up the results real quick. 50% of you think that it's going to end in a draw.
I think we might be being trolled.
Yeah. that doesn't seem like a lot of you have been voting. So let's just, it's very easy. Yeah, we just have four votes. So I encourage you guys to vote. It's basically like a federal election, just a little less serious, to be honest.
Yeah, one doesn't decide how the country is going to play out.
Yeah, exactly. Something that happens in Britain from time to time.
Yeah, every 4 years.
Every 4
years. Yeah. I should say that sounding more convincingly I know, but I hear about it and go, oh yeah, I got to go do that.
Yeah. All right. So at this point in time, the head judge is over. He's not just going to go up to the table and say, this is my ruling. Of course, he first wants to talk to both players. He wants to hear both sides of the story, what happened. And also hear from the spectators and table judges that were at the table. So he gets like a complete picture. And then when he has, I would say, perfect information, or at least something close to perfect information, he will make his ruling based on that.
Yeah, I believe it's the assistant head judge it's Pascal who's come over.
Yes.
When you were saying here, I was thinking, Natalie is the head judge. Yes. And I was like, oh, hold on a second. Yeah, no, I know what's going on.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So if you are interested in becoming a judge, something that we have highlighted also yesterday. We did some interviews with judges, with one of our dedicated volunteers, three of our dedicated volunteers, in fact, who travel to these events to help out and make them possible in the first place. You can become a judge. Everybody can become a judge. It's really easy, in fact. You can do a test, rules knowledge test online, to prove to your local store owner or to a tournament organizer that you do know the rules of the game.
Yep.
And then you can just apply for that role. And once you've collected some experience, and another thing that you could do is reply to some rules questions online on the various message boards, make a name for yourself, then you can apply for a position in one of these larger events like the YCS.
Yep, we do go through. We do try and make sure we pick up a certain number of new people each time when a decision is made. We get a group of our experienced judges that we need to run the event, and then we also choose a few extra people. And you can get onto the circuit this way.
Yeah,
it is a lot of fun. We have the utmost respect for all of our judges. Without them, we couldn't run these events.
Right. So even if playing is not your thing for whatever reason, there are other options to get, like, on the train.
Yeah.
And visit different places like London in England or like Paris in France. Not my first choice, but okay. You can go to other... What?
Just Paris is lovely.
Oh, yeah. You were there with your girlfriend. That might be a little bit different than going there with a bunch of Yu-Gi-Oh! Players.
I don't know. I liked Paris. I thought it was okay.
All right?
Yeah.
Okay. Well,
I'm not lying at all.
I would prefer literally every other place, apart from Venice. I don't like Venice.
I went to Venice when I was really, really young, actually. I've not been to Venice since, but it was like right in the middle of summer, and it was just so hot when I was there. It was just like a concrete jungle on a river.
Pretty much, yeah. With water in between, and yeah, pretty much. All right, speaking of places, the YCS at the moment is in London, the largest event of the year. I can say that with a lot of confidence, to be honest. It's very hard to beat that. And right. We are going to go on a short break, and we'll be back as soon as the match continues, because the issue is going on for a little bit longer. Stay tuned. We're going to be back with that match.
With these three monsters, I build the overlay network. Going to unleash a force greater than anything you've ever faced. It will bring a whirlwind of agony and destruction. But before it appears, it will need a huge supply of energy.
Oh no. It is draining the other number's power. I feel myself growing weaker.
I exceed summon number 53! Potter!
Once again, we're back at YCS Madrid, where more than 460 players have signed up to battle for, well, glory, of course, but also quite some few prizes.
Yes, we've got a lot of goodies for the players that make it, the elite few that make it into the final four, well, the final eight even.
Right.
We've got the prizes behind us, and we can just show you a quick look of what you're missing out on if you're sat at home at the moment.
Yeah. So, first place walks away with a brand new laptop that you can use to watch the stream at home, for example. That's my recommendation.
That's exactly what it should be used for.
Then we got a winner trophy, of course, to like tell your friends in all eternity, hey, I was winning a Yu-Gi-Oh! Tournament back then, and I did so with a very cool deck, in fact. Maybe Monarchs, like we saw in the first round.
Yeah.
So then we got an iPad up for grabs. It's also quite cool.
Everyone loves iPads.
Yeah.
Yeah, you know, it's great for, again, watching the stream. Yes, that's what you want to use it
that,
for.
That's what you want to use it.
We'll talk a little bit about the prize card, actually, because that's one of the main things that's going to get your attention.
So we are the lucky ones who already have one of these. So this is what when you work the stream, you get a prize card.
That's not true.
That's not true.
That's not. That's
you
not
have
what happened.
To actually do well at an event to walk away with a prize card. So we're not giving them away easily, and it really pays out to do well, because Ascension Sky Dragon. It's one of the best synchro monsters in the game, right?
It's an incredibly powerful synchro monster. I was already having people come up and explain to me how they can create combos for OTK.
In case you were wondering, we took a little break because Matt's presence was requested.
Yeah, we had a bit of a complicated rules situation where the head judge wanted to actually check something for how they're going to build this this chain up. So that's going to be able to be resolved now.
And you're the man to go to because you are working in R&D.
Yeah, I work alongside the R&D team.
Yeah.
I don't work in Japan, So I can't say directly I work in R&D, but I work very closely with them on a lot of things.
Good. So the question was, as far as I'm aware, is everything happen at the same time?
Yeah, with a fusion spell.
With a fusion spell?
It's an interesting question, because I don't think the conversation's come up before. Yeah, it was just trying to figure out how the chain builds, and this is being resolved now.
Right. So there we have it. The L should all construct hitting play. And the question for Marcelo was, can I build the chain in any way I want, or am I somewhat restricted because of the timing?
Of when everything's sent to the graveyard and stuff.
Yeah. And there we got the bottomless trap hole that Michael activated to get rid of the construct.
Yeah, that's bottomless trap hole putting in the work there, because the construct will not be allowed to return the Shadow fusion back to Marcelo's hand. We'll still get the Shadow Beast and the Construct effect triggering to send the card from his deck to the graveyard.
Right. But as you can see, we're back with the game. That is quite something. At first, we really thought we were missing something. Well, like, what's the big situation here? What's the question? But it was a good question. Like, yeah. How does the fusion exactly work?
Yeah, you know, it could have been worse. We've had worse. But yeah, it worked out. And we're going to see how this game progresses at this point.
All right. So this doesn't look like a very bad situation for Michael, but Marcelo still holds on to some... He's still got some aces up his sleeve, I would say, with the Blackluster Soldier and Boy of the Beginning more than anything else.
Yeah, and if you consider that Bomber's Trap Hole just being used against Construct, Blackluster Soldier can now enter the field and be... totally fine with chomping through both monsters the opponent controls.
Yes.
I think that's... Is that a Fire King Yakisha? Yes, it is. Yakisha.
Yes. So we can bring that one up for you guys.
Yeah, when Yakisha is destroyed, it'll actually destroy a card in your hand. So it destroys one of the High Avatars.
Yes.
And then that will trigger the High Avatar. So yeah, it's another way. I've actually tricked myself into believing that there were less ways.
He does have ways. I'm certain of that, because I've seen the Fire King deck in action before.
Okay, so yeah, here comes the Blackluster Soldier.
Yeah, no surprise there. And now with Michael being stripped of so much as a back row, I mean, he's got a face-up card there, which is a Fire Formation Tanky, which doesn't really do anything right now. Marcelo he's cleared the path to go for some attacks, doesn't he?
Yeah, well, what actually he chose to do there was he knows his opponent has the Fire King High Avatar Grunix in his hand from a compulsory evacuation earlier.
Right.
So he doesn't want to attack into the Yakisha and trigger the High Avatar, because the High Avatar just comes back in the standby phase and destroys the Blackluster Soldier. So he elects to use the effect to banish it. He has summoned it in attack mode, because he can't attack this turn. I'm wondering if he's concerned about number 101 being pulled up from a Coat Soldier. Granted, had he put it in defense mode, there's every opportunity that it could have been just Castell that came out instead.
Right, so the Tiger King just got rid of the second material.
Which should negate the effects of all face-up cards on the field, I believe.
I guess that is the reasoning here. Marcelo, I'm pretty certain Marcelo was done with his turn, and it should be Michael's turn. Let's check his hand. So I think the Onslaught of the Fire Kings is the card he just drew into.
Yep.
That seems to make sense. And he's got Soul Charge, two copies of the High Avatar, and Barong, and the not High Avatar Garunix.
Yeah, the little Garunix.
Which he just summoned. So let's bring that one up again. Yeah, if you're really not familiar with this deck, it can do some crazy stuff. It's just nobody seems to be aware of the power of the Fire Kings. But Michael Chiplock is a big fan of the deck.
It creates this really difficult game state to get through, where it just if you get two Grunixes, just High Avatar Grunixes coming into play, blowing each other up. You just get a cycle every turn of field clearing, and that can just be very difficult to deal with, because the monster itself has a huge number of attack points.
Yes. So, did he just attack into the Blackluster Soldier?
I believe he's declared an attack, and Marcelo is considering a response. Yep, the life points have been updated.
Yes. So this way, Michael can trigger the effect of his Avatar Garunix. And that, like we said before, it allows him to special summon a Fire King Avatar monster from his deck, which in this case is Yaksha, which we just had on the field a second ago. And Yaksha is also being sent to Black Luster Soldier, so he takes even more damage.
There's a lot of life points to trade for this.
And you might be wondering, why is he doing this? And well, the reason is that this way he can trigger the effect of Yaksha, and that one allows him to destroy a card in his hand, which is the High Avatar Garunix, which just got sent to the graveyard for that reason. And it's a little bit like the Sacred Phoenix of Neftis, isn't it?
A little bit, yeah, except instead of doing spells and traps, it goes after monster cards. It also has an effect if it's destroyed in battle, which the Sacred Phoenix
didn't have, yeah.
I played that in one of the first Nationals I ever played in. I played a single copy of Hand of Nephis and Sacred Phoenix.
Right.
Great effect.
So, and now after he lost all of his monsters, he plays Onslaught of the Fire King. So, Michael Chiplak really committing a lot of life points into this string of plays. In case you can't read the effect text of Onslaught, it says, if your opponent controls a monster and you control no monsters, which is now the case, he can special summon a fire beast, beast warrior, or winged beast type monster from his deck. The effects are being negated, and it's destroyed during the end phase. So there's not that much he can do with it, but knowing Michael Chiplak, he does have a plan. And with a Soul Charge in hand, oh no, he couldn't activate it, he already attacked.
Yeah, so with the Fire King High Avatar of Garunix, if he summons that, the remaining copy in his deck with the Onslaught, it will be destroyed during the end phase, and it will come back up in the standby phase alongside the other Garunix that was sent by Yaksha, and then he'll start his cycle of, I'm going to clear the field every turn.
Right. The big question for me at this point is, how does he survive the next turn? Because he only has 3,600 life points.
Well, the Garunixes will be summoned during Marcelo's standby phase.
During the opponent's standby phase.
Yeah.
All right. I was thinking it's your own standby phase, but it isn't. All right.
Okay, so we're going to see Artifact Sanctum being used to bring out Morale Tack, which will destroy the Fire Formation Tenki.
Yes.
I believe.
So, yeah. Let's look at Marcelo's hand again, because that's pretty much what he will be left with in just a second, isn't it?
Yep. Both of these.
So he draws for his turn, and then...
Breakthrough skill being used from the graveyard.
So he gets to keep his field, which is, of course, very important. Breakthrough skill gets banished. This is one of the reasons why this card is so powerful. After the first activation, you can always use it on your own turn. It doesn't need to be in your main phase.
Yeah, it catches so many of these plays off guard.
Because you don't check the opponent's graveyard for a card like that. You just look like, do you have any targets for Call of the Haunted?
Yeah, I mean, you definitely have to track the breakthrough skills these days, because it's just put this horrible situation now for Michael, who was expecting to clear both these monsters out, and instead he's given up most of his life points and left.
Well, I would argue that he didn't really have any other line of plays, did he?
Right there, no. The Black Luster Soldier was certainly looking like it was just going to clean up. So he has to get the Black Luster Soldier out. And committing to it and runs into the breakthrough skill.
Right. So it does look very good, very promising for Marcelo. The High Avatar Garunix is not really posing much of a threat when you have a Black Luster Soldier on the field. Even though Tenki is still on the field, but it only gives Beast Warrior type monster something.
That's correct. Plus 100 attack.
And it's a winged beast, so it doesn't make much of a difference. There's a Shadow Fusion that Marcelo currently activates. While it is not for free, and it costs him the cards in his hand, which are Shadow Squamata and Shadow Beast, he does get to special summon another monster. In this case, again, El Shadow Construct. And with so much damage on the field, I think that is pretty much it, isn't it?
Yeah, the Garunix can special summon a monster when it's destroyed. I believe it's level 4 or lower.
Let's bring it up one more time.
Yeah, what could happen here is Grunix was special summoned, so the construct could just destroy the Grunix. It's not going to come back until the next standby phase, and then two direct attacks from the Blackbuster Soldier and Moraltak will finish this game up, excluding any hand traps, which we know Marcel doesn't have.
Yes. I was mistaken, by the way. It wasn't Squamato that was sent to the graveyard. It was Felice Lightsworn Archer
as
material for the fusion. So there we have Squamata, which has...
That's a Shadow Beast in play.
So there seems to be like a little bit of mess up on the app. But we will have it resolved in just a second.
Oh, okay. This is an interesting way to close the game out. Using number 61 Volcasaurus to use its effect to destroy the Grunix and inflict damage. And now we're going to see a Baron coming out of the hand and using its effect.
And Marcelo is already checking. He's like, what happens if I attack now?
Yeah, he hasn't actually... I don't believe he's entered his battle phase just yet, because he's just used number 61 to clean out that first monster. Oh yeah, he shows the guy a charger, which has piercing, and is able to close out the game.
Yes. All right.
That was quite a long game with the appeal in the middle.
Yes, and the very interesting choice of Marcelo, where we thought he's just going to attack or something, and then he just goes for, oh, let's do another summon, and then eventually go for Volcasaurus.
Yeah, there was a number of ways Marcelo could have won that game, and that's just the one he chose.
So, in this first game, not the strongest showing of Fire Kings that we've seen, still, the siding procedure that is happening right at this point in time could make all the difference, with Michael having quite a few options, of course, also against the Shadol deck, because that's to be expected. He's running, most notably, three copies of Shadow Imprisoning Mirror.
Yep, they do absolutely nothing against his own deck, whilst completely shutting down the opponent's deck. Two Noblemen of Crossite potentially coming in as well as options to take out the face-down Shadow monsters before they flip.
Yep.
Chainsaw's appearance is probably not going to make an appearance this match because it's good against Burning Abyss. I'm not sure it's so good against...
We haven't seen any tour guides. And that is one of the cards that you really want to have a chain disappearance against.
Yes, just something just to stop your opponent steamrolling you.
Yeah. Interesting choice is a copy of Cursed Seal of the Forbidden Spell. I haven't seen that one in quite a while, to be honest. But if you counter the first Shadow Fusion, you're going to be safe from that card for the rest of the whole duel.
Yeah, because your opponent can't activate that card at all.
And that is a big difference maker.
That's huge, but the... Going over to Marcelo's deck, he does main deck a Wiretap, which could make that a 2-for-1 because your opponent pays the cost of discarding the spell card. Gets Wiretapped, the Shadow Fusion resolves, and that can go wrong completely. In the side deck for Marcelo, we see Riser, Mind Control, Defusion.
There's a Monarch. Monarch seems like Stormforth. A Testalos. Oh no, it's Monarch Stormforth, yeah.
I believe that's what that is. Two Mystical Space Typhoons, a Malevolent Catastrophe, Trap Stun, Change Disappearance, Raikou, and a Rageki.
So interesting, but he doesn't seem to be having that many options against the Fire Kings, does he?
Yeah, to be honest, it's a deck he probably didn't consider playing against in any serious capacity.
Yeah. Which is a fair assumption.
Yeah.
I mean, the chances are pretty, pretty slim.
Based on the results from Madrid and what we've seen in the US, it was unlikely to expect a Fire King matchup at this stage of the tournament.
Yes, and we also got 5 in the whole tournament. So 5 players out of 1,195 that came to London, that made the trip, are playing Fire Kings. So the odds are so bad. I mean, you could say, okay, the odds are a little bit better because he's a good player and Michael Chiplock is a good player, so there's a higher chance that they play against each other at some point. But you don't expect them to. You don't expect to be getting paired against a certain player.
Yeah, do you just go? So yeah, you just don't expect to anticipate to play against Fire Kings in a format like this one. And Marcelo even being able to take that game down without his side deck, and when playing a deck that your opponent's not expecting, is the biggest advantage of a rogue hidden strategy. If you're losing your game one with your rogue deck, there's if you're losing a lot of your game ones, then your deck's not doing what it's supposed to do, because you really want to win game one before the side deck cards get involved.
Right. So here we have the opening five of Michael Chiplock for the second game. But he opted against going first. He instead had Marcelo go first, who's got these cards in hand, two copies of Moraltach, Shadow Beast, and the Monarch Stormforce. So he sided into that card. The card on his field is Breakthrough Skill. So let's go back to Michael Chiplock. He activates, just as expected, Fire Formation Tenki, and that gets him Fire King Avatar Barong. So let's take a look, another look at his hand now. And no surprise there. He's summoning Yaksha and attacking with it, dealing first blood.
The interesting thing there is he's shown his opponent the Barong with the Fire Formation Tenki. So he's potentially trying to mislead Marcelo into thinking how this Yaksha is going to resolve. He could think, okay, he's going to destroy the Barong and he's going to search himself for an onslaught of the Fire Kings. Marcelo could then make his sequence of plays based on that information and call it wrong, because his opponent then just destroys the Gruinix in hand and changes everything.
Yeah.
But Mordai Stormforth, setting a Shadow Beast, is going to be the play of choice from Marcelo to get around this Yaksha conundrum.
That's a pretty interesting choice, but definitely not a bad choice. Now, Michael has a Mystical Space Typhoon to clear out the Breakthrough skill, but Marcelo might get some extra use out of that later on, just like we saw in the first duel.
Yeah, but potentially right here, he's now using the Onslaught of the Fire Kings to summon Gruinix.
That seems like one of the very best situations to make use of the Onslaught.
Yeah.
So, if you just zoomed in, you were missing the first game for whatever reason, it basically says the same as Cyber Dragon. If your opponent has a monster and you don't have a monster, you can special summon something. But rather than the Cyber Dragon, it's a Fire Beast Warrior, or Winged Beast Monster from your deck, which in this case is the High Avatar Gruinix.
Yep, Shadow Beast being flipped up and attacked from Barong. That's going to add two more cards to Marcelo's hand, and Marcelo gets to discard one of his other cards.
So he discards a Moraltach.
That's one of his two Moraltachs.
Right. So let's check his hand again. There you see it, the Moraltach disappearing. And he's now left with, well, a Monarch, Shadow Beast, and a Mathematician. Whereas now Michael triggered the effect of his High Avatar, Gruinix, which doesn't really get him a lot of value in that situation, but he certainly won't mind.
It'll trigger the Barong, and Barong gets the ability to search for a Fire King's card during the end phase. Is it during the end phase, I believe, or is it during your next standby phase?
Let's see. During the standby phase, after this card was destroyed by a card effect and sent to the graveyard, add one Fire King card from your deck to your hand, except Fire King Avatar Barong. But that is... If a face-up Fire King monster you control is destroyed by a card effect, except during the damage step, when that happens in the end phase, it triggers, you can special summon this card from your hand. No, this is also not what happened.
So the Gruinix will destroy the Barong. The Barong, during next standby phase, will let Michael search for his follow-up play. All in the meantime, his opponent has to deal with...
the High Avatar.
Yeah. Oh, and he responded by dropping the Yaksha to the destruction of his Barong, from the looks of it.
Okay, so now we have resolved that little bit of confusing interactions here with the Fire Kings. It's Marcelo's turn at the moment, and he summoned Mathematician, which allows him to send something to the graveyard. That was one of the ongoing discussions we had in Madrid.
Yeah.
Between running either Armageddon Knight or Mathematician.
Ultimately, it looks like Mathematician has won the argument for most people for its ability to be able to send anything to the graveyard and beat Shadow Falco in the mirror match. The 1500 attack points being very, very powerful compared to something like Armageddon Knight, which can also send Shadow Beast from the deck to the graveyard or something as well. Allowing you to draw a card, and it doesn't turn into a Go-Go Guardian if your opponent takes control of your Armageddon Knight and uses Shadow Falco.
Yes.
Or takes your Armageddon Knight with a Go-Go Guardian and then uses your own Armageddon Knight against you.
Right. So these are the somewhat usual combos of the Shadows that you see all the time.
Yep, we saw Shadow Falco being sent to the graveyard, Falco then being special summoned. There's a beast already waiting in the graveyard. So that can be summoned back with the Shadow Falco. So Marcelo actually making a pretty good wall for himself, or at least we'll drag this out for another turn or two.
Yes. Michael drew into a Solemn Warning. He already had an Effect Veiler in hand and another copy of the High Avatar Garunics with the one on his field.
If we remember, the Barong effect triggers, and he decided to search for Onslaught with the Fire Kings, which is very, very good at dodging the breakthrough skill that we already know is in Marcelo's graveyard, whilst bringing back another monster or triggering even his own monsters. A very, very good quick play spell.
Yes, and he just got back the Onslaught of the Fire Kings. So he is in a pretty good position, I think. With, well, quite a few cards in hand and quite an impressive field. But it's a little bit too early to tell where this is going. So the mathematician gets struck down.
Yeah, it's 1,200 points of damage going to go through from the Garunix. And we'll see where he goes from here. We'll see where Michael goes from here. He sets two cards and passes a turn.
Right, so let's check his grave again. His field again. That's a Circle of the Fire Kings and a Solemn Warning.
Pretty good. Pretty good position to be in.
Let's see what Marcelo draws. He already had the Shadow Beast, the Rise of the Storm Monarch, and a Shadow Fusion. And he just added another card to his hand.
And we're flipping up the Shadow Falco. Effect Veiler being used. That's going to shut down the Shadow Falco.
There we go. This is the new card. Compulsory Evocation Device. Well, crucial Effect Veiler, isn't it?
Yeah, at this point he's now got the Falco in attack position, and I believe that's just under game if the Garunix attacks over it. It's like it leaves him on 100 life points if that Garunix successfully connects. We know that there is a compulsory evacuation device to stop that.
Yeah, and there's also the chance that Marcelo simply follows it up, that flip summon with a Rise of the Storm Monarch play.
I feel like that's his best play here. Yeah, I'm not missing anything face down. The morale attack's not going to do anything. Mystical Space Typhoon on its own not going to change the situation, so almost certainly we're going to see Ryza.
Yeah, it seems like this Shadow Falco is not going to hang on for much longer. Oh. Surprisingly, okay. There's a Shadow Fusion, and Michael thinks about activating something. He does have the Solemn Warning, but he opts against using it.
Okay. Probably not worried about either of the two cards that could come out, which is why he's decided to not use the Solemn Warning yet.
So, for the time being, Marcelo doesn't have the strongest monster on the field because Michael's High Avatar Garunix is still stronger than his Winder. So, that doesn't seem to be changing that much.
No, he's just summoned a monster to mostly get the Falco off the table, so it's just not attacked, I'm getting the impression from. I mean, Marcelo could potentially get out of this, but he's looking... I don't know, he's actually looking all right. He's got the compulsory evacuation, which answers the Garunix. He thinks it does. I mean, there's that Onslaught of the Fire Kings. No, he must know that. He saw the Onslaught of the Fire Kings being searched, so even if he tries to compulsory evacuation a device, the Garunix. Now he's controlling the Winder. Only one special summon per turn could be made.
Yes.
So if he does try, he won't be able to use Circle of the Fire Kings. So this actually could play out very well for Marcelo.
Which is interesting, because just a second ago we thought he was standing on the brink of defeat.
Yeah, he was, but...
He has certainly found the one way out. So, Michael, this is his field. He doesn't have any cards in hand, so there's no hidden surprises. And there's a Moraltach hitting the field, which is really bad news with the Shadow Imprisoning Mirror, because Moraltach is not a dark monster.
That's correct, and he's almost certainly not going to want to flip the Imprisoning Mirror until... After that, there's a compulsory.
Yeah. So, but now Michael doesn't have any cards on the field anymore, any monsters. which means, well, he would be up for an Onslaught of the Fire Kings. However, he has Circle of the Fire Kings. That is a different card. Just in case you got confused here.
Yeah, so the Grunix is going to come back and destroy a monster on the field. Elshar Winder cannot be destroyed by card effects. And, oh, hold on. Let's, perhaps he's just checking before he confirms that that play is okay.
Well, it certainly looks like it to me. So we got the Morotach on the field still, together with the Winder. And the face down cards for Marcelo are the Mystical Space Typhoon and, well, it's not a Shadow Dragon. I'm very certain of that.
So okay, yeah, it's a breakthrough skill that Marcelo's just remembered. Oh, no, he decides to not use it.
Yeah, it appears a little bit like we got some technical difficulties with our app that is showing you the cards, because now it seems to be up to speed again. Yeah, there we go. So there's Morotach is face down, it's set, and Space Typhoon. And the last card, one of the two cards in hand that he had, which were Rise of the Storm Monarch and Shadow Dragon, just got set. So the Shadow Dragon is the face down monster on Marcelo's side of the field.
Very good answer to the Garunix.
Yes.
As it returns it to the hand, as we just saw the other compulsory do.
All right, so here's Michael's field, and we also got Michael's hand. It's a high avatar Garunix and another copy of compulsory, which is a very strong removal against fusion monsters.
Any extra deck monster despises compulsory evacuation device. It's one of the reasons it's limited.
Yeah, so there's a MST from Marcelo, and rather than targeting one of the three cards that Michael has, he targets his own Morotach, which is a... There is a reason for that, of course, and that reason is that it triggers its effect. It will be special summoned back to the field and allow him to take out a face-up card.
Yep, which would be the high avatar, but Michael, considering his response here...
There is the Solemn Warning. Very interesting point in time to activate this. Here is the attack, the following attack with the high avatar, and he flips the Shadow Imprisoning Mirror, making sure that Marcelo's monster's effect doesn't trigger, which really puts Michael ahead in this game.
Yeah, but he...
For the time being.
Yeah, he had to give up the Solemn Warning, didn't he, there? So what could happen here is I think we're going to see Dragon flipped and then Circle of Fire Kings being forced. No, he doesn't flip it. Oh, because Shadow Imprisoned Mirror is not going to stop him using it, so he's just going to try and use the Riser to turn it back. And we're going to see Circle of the Fire Kings just trading for a Yakisha.
Which is excellent, because Michael removes the target for Riser, and that way he doesn't get thrown behind, where he will draw into the same card again.
Yeah, I think that's game for Michael, because even if Michael takes out the Yakisha, the Garunix is going to come back next turn, clear the field, and that's going to be 2,700.
We can see that Michael is already in that zone. He's already like, yes, I got this. Whereas Marcelo is still waiting for his opponent to like put his cards down on the table and see what happens. Although, like to us, of course, we got perfect information. It's very clear what happens. There is an attack. Shouldn't that be enough?
Yeah, according to the life points I got there, yeah.
It is enough.
Yeah, I think he's just drawing to see.
Marcelo was just curious to see what else he would be drawing into, which is not a good strategy, is what people have told me. Because
yeah,
you're always going to be angry. Like,
yeah, there's no positive thing you can get from saying, oh, what would I got with that one more card? There's no outcome, because you realize, A, I could have won the game, you're going to feel bad that you lost by a turn.
Yes.
Or B, you realize that you had nothing and you feel extra hopeless.
Yeah, I don't see what's there to gain for you.
I don't know, maybe it's just a pride thing going, oh, could I have won? Like, you know, some people have to know, other people don't need to know. It's like whenever somebody sends me one of those things that says, oh, you can find out when you're going to die, I'm always like, I don't want to know that. Like, why on earth would anybody want to know that?
Well, some people would say, like, okay, I want to make it count before I go, but why not make it count now?
Yeah, let's get back into card games, because...
Well, yesterday there was a very philosophical discussion at the judge game table. One of the judge game tables, and at some point you were really wondering, how did these guys get together? Like, how did this happen? And they were talking about what happens if a tree comes down in a wood.
Oh, this old question. Does it make a sound?
Yeah, doesn't make a sound, and so on. And they were getting really, really lost in the argument. They went like three levels deep. Inception was nothing compared to that. And I was just sitting next there. I was just starting to ignore them because it was just impossible to keep track with them. But Chacha still made it all right to the venue today, even though those tiring discussions went on half the night yesterday.
Yeah, they were here on site for 7 a.m. sharp.
Yes.
For pre-briefings and getting ready for how this event's going to work.
Yeah.
I don't actually know how much time is left on this. I know that there was an appeal and a time extension, and we started a little bit later than the main round, because I've already heard the clock go quite a while ago for the main round.
Oh, okay. I have to admit, I didn't even hear the clock. But like you said, there can't be that much time, which is something to consider when you are side-decking. I mean, last time in Madrid, we have seen one player playing Mystic Walk just for that particular scenario,
so
where you're like,
yeah,
if I'm going to timeout, I want to have a way of like adding a lot more life points.
Yeah, all I have to do is have more life points than you to win.
Yeah. And especially if the opponent is leading by like 500 or let's make it 1,000, and he doesn't expect you to have a way to increase your life points by a significant amount. Normally the worst that could happen is a Gagaga Cowboy. Everything else is like, yeah, well...
Or your opponent goes for the Cowboy and you go, Chain Mystic Walk.
Yeah.
Oh, that's only 800, you still lose.
Exactly. That would be one of the best ways to use that card. So we will have the cards in hand up shortly for you again in our third and also final duel of the round. We are starting with Michael's hand, where we see another Shadow Imprisoning Mirror, Brotherhood of the Fire Fist Bear, Mystical Space Typhoon, and, well, two more cards in hand. Is that a Bottomless on the very right? No.
Fact Failure, Dustinado, Mystical Space Typhoon.
It's a Dustinado, right. And again, Marcelo is kicking things off, and he sets a card to each zone. That is his hand, or rather was his hand. You can expect the Mystical Space Typhoon that is now on the field, and most likely the Shadol Hedgehog, isn't it?
Yeah, none of the other... He can't set the Beast because it's level 5, and Falco with no Sinister Shadow games would be pointless, so it's definitely going to be the Hedgehog going face down.
Right. So the MST got forced really early by the copy of the same card by Michael. So this is also interesting. It depends a lot on the deck if this is an advantage for you. If your opponent is losing one card and you are losing one card. Most of the time, if you're playing a very fast deck, you want that. You want to like simplify the game state.
Yeah, there's some decks that just thrive in an environment of where the fewer number of cards, my single cards are better than your ones.
Yeah, and Infinity would be one of those.
Yeah, well, when Infinity gets to its top decking, all of its cards are supercharged because you have no card in hand. As compared to, say, a Lightsworn deck, which... has the Judgment Dragon as a top deck, but a lot of its other monsters are not so amazing.
Right. So Michael's field after his first turn is a Fire King Avatar Garunix. That's the face-down monster. The Shadow Imprisoning Mirror, which is the face-up card, as you can see. And the Dust Tornado, which is probably a possible reason why he got rid of his MST so quickly, because he's like, yeah, well, I got another card anyway that does the same thing.
Yeah. Well, he starts with an extra card as well, so he's... definitely force on simplify against that. But what we just saw there is Michael used Effect Veiler on Marcelo's monster to stop before it attacked. So he's actually telegraphed that his face down card is incredibly important, because he needs to stop this Armides. Armides has an effect that stops your opponent using card effects till the end of the damage step when it attacks. So it shuts down flip effects and stuff like this, because this all happens during the damage step. So that preemptive Effect Veiler before the battle phase is entered means that if Armides wants to attack, it is going to trigger whatever that set card is.
Yes. So it wouldn't be too unlikely if Marcelo decides to not attack, which is exactly what happens here. He adds a breakthrough skill to his back row, which gets cleared out by the Dust Tornado by Michael right away. Not that surprising. That leaves Marcelo with the following cards in hand. Shadol Beast and a Blackluster Soldier. Again, a Blackluster Soldier so early in the game. Good for him that Armades, let's bring him up one more time, is a light monster.
Yes, which will pair very nicely with the Blackluster Soldier that he's got in his hand.
Right. So Michael's field is now still the Garunix and the Viking Avatar Yaksha. Both of these are having trouble dealing with Armadas. because they, most of the time, they trigger in the battle phase, of course.
Yeah, let's. Michael in a bit of an awkward position, but then Marcelo also facing down Shadow Imprisoning Mirror with no answer. He set his mystical space to Fiend very early in the duel. That's one that a lot of high-level players would question. If there is a card that's going to stop you playing the game, is setting that mystical space to Fiend to attempt to bluff your opponent worth it if your opponent then takes it out with a blind mystical space to Fiend?
Yeah.
So now he doesn't have an answer for the Shadow Imprisoning Mirror. Now, he could have just not set the mystical space to Fiend. His opponent would still have his, but he'd have an answer to the Shadow Imprisoning Mirror.
Yeah. All right, so now Michael got to, well, at least force the effect of one of his two monsters, or he can now. He flip summoned Yaksha. And our app is slightly confused here because it says that Fire Fist Bear is on the field.
Ah, that's definitely not on the field from what I can see.
Yeah.
Maybe the bear is in... Oh, he's got Coach Soldier in his hand.
Yes.
Was a bear destroyed on a previous attack?
No.
Okay, so yeah.
All right, so it seems like the charge that is working the app on the other side has been getting a little bit ahead of himself. So let's check this again. We got the Wolf Bark in hand. And I think the Brother of the Fire Fist Bear is also in the hand of Michael Chiplak. So he's got two cards in hand and two cards on the field. Shadow Imprisoning Mirror, quite obvious there. And the Fire King Avatar Yaksha. Yes, what you pointed out, that setting the MST didn't seem to be like the best play here. Quite a few people on the chat agree with that.
Yeah.
Like, well, there's no need for that.
What it actually does is it telegraphs that you also have a very weak hand because you hadn't, of your defensive options, you chose to set nothing but the mystical space to make your opponent have defenses. So you could psychologically say, I'm trying to convince my opponent I have a stronger hand than I should.
Right. So
we're seeing, I think that's Castiel? Yep.
Yes.
Castiel shuffling away the Armides. Oh, that's just Blackluster Soldier. That Armides getting shuffled away takes away the only light option that was available for that Blackluster Soldier.
Yes,
so
let's bring up Castiel again. So that was one of the very best options that Michael had to deal with that threat. And make sure that his opponent would not get to use his Blackluster Soldier. And as you can see by the moves on the table, if you can read Yu-Gi-Oh! Sign language, that means we are in overtime, and this is how many turns are following after this one. Like, it's yours, mine, yours again, and then we end the game. So it appears like time was called on our feature match. Most of the time, we also do have a dice on the table to indicate that, but it was very clear from the sign language what's going on here.
Yeah. Interestingly, even the Castell face up on the field for this makes all the Shadow fusions that Marcel have are a lot better because he is still leaving an Xe monster, but he's Michael has denied the light aspect for Blackluster Soldier for Marcel, so he just summons Squamata, I think, and attacks over, and a handshake comes up.
Yeah, because Michael gets to do some damage, and Marcelo knows that he cannot do any damage anytime soon, or in his last turn that is remaining for him. Or it already was the last turn, I'm not 100% sure. But in any case, Michael comes out successful on top. And very interesting way that this match has ended, because we said that time is about to be called, but you didn't really see that this was about to happen.
Yeah, the handler for Marcelo looked pretty weak at that end. When his Armides got shuffled away, he knew he was in trouble. He was holding a Blacklister Soldier.
Yes,
he can't play.
You could also tell. Like, he was sitting on the table, very tense, and then it gets shuffled away. And he's like, you can tell.
Both cards in my hand, immediately I can't play. Whatever I can play is off the top.
Yes.
And the Shadow Imprisoning Mirror is still shutting down a huge bunch of his deck.
Yeah.
Again, that Mystical Space Typhoon at the start of the game, that could have been the reason that he lost.
Yeah, it could have been the difference maker here.
Had he had access to his Dark Monster effects, because he just took a risk that he didn't need to take. Threw away the mystical space Typhoon, yes. And it got punished for it.
Well, simple things can make a big difference in this game. It's all about timing, when to use your cards. It's not just like what cards did you draw into, it's also like when to use them.
Yeah, and when that mystical space Typhoon was so clutch for him in that game, setting it was a bit careless.
Yeah.
And that's one of the reasons he lost.
I mean, you wanna goad your opponent, you wanna make him think that you have something in your back row so he doesn't go for like a big special summon because he might be fearing something like a Torrential Tribute or...
Yeah.
In the end, Michael Chiplock, the Fire King player, is successful again. We like I said, we have seen this before a couple of times. It's his favorite deck, and that is the reason why. It just catches opponents off guard, and he doesn't seem to be making any mistakes, does he?
No, he played very, very well there. He's moving forward 4-0. He's halfway there to the next day. Four more rounds to go. That one was pretty mentally intensive,
yes.
I imagine. So
a lot more tense and close compared to the first.
Yeah,
three
other games have all been pretty one-sided, but that's worked out really well for him.
Right.
Bit of methodological? Am I saying the word right?
Yeah,
play that wins him the game.
Yeah. Well, very interesting. We have pretty much gone over all the cards in his deck throughout this match. Is there anything we didn't see that could make a difference later on?
No. I mean, he had a Heartland Draco, which he could have used to sneak damage in for the late stages. I don't think there's anything there that's
super out of the ordinary.
That's super out of the ordinary for us to expect. I can't read the sign that's being held up, but my eyesight's actually getting worse and worse.
All right, let's just quickly talk about Marcelo's deck. Although there doesn't seem to be anything super new. I mean, we have seen the Wiretap in the main deck.
Yeah, Wiretap again, Burning Abyss. Against Burning Abyss is very, very good.
And he's playing one copy of Traps then.
Yeah.
So basically, he came to the same conclusion as Ali Fawaz.
Yeah.
All right. So we will try to talk to some more players in between rounds to give you some more updates on where the competitive scene is developing in what direction. Speaking of competing, we will have a feature on the organized play right up for you.
Yeah, I got to sit down and interview Rob Hooley and ask him for a few thoughts about organized play. You're going to want to catch this one.
Yeah,
it was a good interview.
Some good announcements, I heard.
Wait and see.
All right.